Oh my heavens. Did you guys know it's a new year? Yeah! Can you stand with us? We're going to worship God this morning. Come on, put your hands together. My world was shaking. My world was shaking. My heart was broken. My hope is fading, the walls are closing. But now I'm singing, look how he lifted me. My life is sinking, my days are numbered. The waves are crashing, the flood is coming. Oh hallelujah, look how he lifted me.
Sing it out. Song and about this weekend, and I just felt like God was talking to me about what mercy is. It's like the king giving the pardon to the one who's been judged guilty. God has shown mercy to us. 2016 is old. It's past. It's got nothing to do with us anymore. God did things in that year that we can appreciate, that we can look back and thank him for. But he wants us to look forward in 2017 with expectancy. Like, we were praying yesterday as worship leaders, and I just saw this tree. And the branches were just You don't really see this in life. You don't see branches reaching. But these branches were reaching through the darkness into the light. And as they did, the strength and the power that came from the light just strengthened that tree all the way through to the roots. The roots just went deeper and deeper. And God just wants to do something amazing in us as people. But part of that is understanding the mercy that's been bestowed on us. We have to know who we are. That we've been loved at such a measure that His only begotten Son came and died on the cross so that we could walk in that power. The same power that rose Him from the dead, that we could be those people. So as we sing this song, Mercy, allow these words to wash over you, but understand on a new level, on prayer, praying, that's my prayer, is that you guys will understand on a new level what His mercy is.
You delight in showing mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. I know that You delight in showing mercy, and mercy triumphs over judgment.
I will wait and spend my days loving the world.
mercy wash over your people, Jesus. Wash away all the sand and silt. Thank you that your mercy triumphs over judgment. You want us to understand how much you love us. Holy Spirit, we invite you to this place. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare your sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Yeah. Your presence, Lord. Come on, tell him he's welcome here this morning.
Tasted and seen of the sweetest.
Sing it out. Big guys, big strong guys, see worship as just not necessarily their thing. But Jacob, this morning as we were praying, talked about seeing big strong men worship the king and how that inspires him. And I think of David dancing around his loincloth, saying that he wanted to be even more undignified than that before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Help us to understand it. It's not an easy thing to do. We don't sing these words over and over and over again to just repeat them, but it's to meditate on them like your word, to meditate on them, to remember that your mercy triumphs over judgment. We want you in this place, we want you in our hearts, and we definitely want you as propelling us into 2017. Take these, your people, and God, fill them up, overflowing, and give them that extra propulsion into 2017 to draw close to you, draw near to you, and to your word, and go forward with fervor. I pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. We're going to ask the ushers to come forward. We're going to receive. You guys are so funny. It's like, we're going to clap. No, we're not. we're going to pray over this offering. God, thank you again and again for the opportunity and privilege as part of our worship to give back. You know, we understand, God, only a smidgen. We can only see so much. But this gift and this offering takes the truth and the love and the grace of Jesus and it literally disperses it throughout the globe. Thank you, God. Thank you that you allow us to be part of that because it's worth it. It is so worth it. Bless this time and this offering. Further your kingdom in Jesus' name and all God's people say.
Amen.
Welcome and thank you for joining us at Pure Heart today. If you are new, please fill out the guest card attached to your bulletin and bring it to the information center in the lobby. We would love to connect with you and help you explore the exciting things available for you and your family. We are constantly moving. The question is, where are we going? Our desire is for everyone to be intentional about their move toward God. There are many ways for you to explore, grow, and pursue a wholehearted relationship with God at Pure Heart, including opportunities to plug into life together. We have small and large groups, both on and off campus, intentionally designed to encourage relationships that will help you engage scripture, prayer, community, and service as you develop the tools to share your faith with others. Pure Heart is also committed to families as they move together toward God. Our next generation ministries provide fun, creative, and challenging opportunities for children and students from nursery through high school. We want them to discover their identity in Christ and their purpose in God's kingdom. Leadership is a vital part of Pure Heart. Every one of us has a role in His kingdom, from serving in our children's ministry and greeting people in the lobby, to volunteering in our local schools and throughout the world. We are passionate about helping you live out your faith as a kingdom worker in your home, workplace, and community as you help others move deeper into a relationship with God. We have so many ways to get connected and involved, but every move begins with a single step. Discover your next step by picking up a copy of the catalog and connecting with us at the information center in the lobby or visit us online at pureheart.org.
Great to see you. How are you doing today? Woo! Awesome. As Pastor Roger just said on the video, we have a passion to help you grow in your faith. And we have a brand new year. Lots of things happen at the church. We're going to draw your attention to a few of the opportunities to connect, grow, and go. If you are interested in going on a mission trip coming up in 2017, we have an informational meeting on Sunday the 22nd. We'd love for you to check that out. If you're interested in going on a mission trip, find a little bit more out about that. You can stop at the missions counter to help you with that. Also, if you're new to the church, maybe you've been here for the last 2 or 3 months or so, we'd love to have you come to our Becoming Part of the Family, which is a class that we start on the 22nd of January, just a few weeks away. And it helps us let you know who we are as a church. You're going to get a chance to meet some of the pastors. You're going to get your questions answered. You're going to find out a little bit about where we are going and what God's doing in us. Also, baptisms are coming up on the 21st and 22nd. Yeah, you can give a hand for that. It's a chance for us to celebrate with you when you've made that decision to follow Christ. And we do it right here in our auditorium, so invite your family, your friends. More information out at the Information Center for that. How many of you today are married or dating or engaged? Raise your hands. Woo, look at that. Yeah. Well, here at Pure Heart, we want to strengthen your relationship.
That's pretty good. In first service, they were like...
Yeah. Well, we want to strengthen marriages around here, so we're participating in a national challenge.
It's not a dating contest, Brian.
It's not a dating contest.
Challenge.
Okay. Why I have a block in my brain.
How many dates can you squeeze in between Valentine's Day?
Well, it's a very simple thing to do. You just go online, pureheart.org, click on the banner, you fill out a quick 10-question survey, and then you go on 2 dates between now and Valentine's Day. It's very simple, and we're hoping to use that data that we gather, not just our church, but churches all across the country, to help strengthen marriages, because we know if we have strong marriages, we have strong families, we have strong communities. Amen? Yeah, you've got a hand for that. That's good! I get a little choked up about that because I want to see strong families, man. I have one. I'm blessed to have one. I want to see more of them. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, and also if you in the last few months have raised your hand and started a relationship with Jesus Christ, we have a class coming up starting on the 22nd, just a couple weeks away, called Move Starting Points. We'd love to walk alongside of you, help you discover more what it means to become like Christ for the sake of others, growing your relationship with God. It's going to be right here on Sunday morning, 8:45. We'll give you breakfast. We're going to have a conversation with you. We'd love to have you sign up for that. More information online. Have a great service.
Give Pastor Brian a big hand. Yeah. Well, Happy New Year, Pure Heart. How you doing? Yeah. Welcome to 2017. Here we go. Last May, we launched a Because It's Worth It generosity campaign. And we called the Pure Heart family to whole new levels of generosity. And I'm here to tell you today that since May, giving in our church family, financial giving, is up 22%. Give God a huge hand for that. God has used your generosity to impact thousands of lives. Over the last 10 years on our campus, we've seen 4,500 plus people say yes to Jesus. Can you give God a big hand for that today? A friend of mine, Mark, he said he brought his whole family last Easter, and every person in the family raised their hand and prayed to receive Christ as Lord of their life. Christmas Eve, every service, every section, people raised their hand to receive Jesus Christ. Give God a big hand for that as well. Yes. 1,500 people baptized last year on our campus. That's an average of, over the last 10 years, that's an average of 150 people a year. The average church in America is like 95 people. 150 people a year baptized. How many of you joined Pure Heart before we moved to this campus? So over 10 years ago, before we got here, raise your hand. Look around, there's quite a few hands. The rest of you have joined us since we've been on this campus. How many started coming to Pure Heart in the last 12 months, in the last year? Raise your hand really high. That is it. Would you please stand? Would you please, you're not going to be alone. You're not going to be alone. Come on, all of you just joined us this last year. Come on, give us a big hand. Woo! Love it. All right, you may be seated. Welcome to the family, everybody. We have such great diversity here, not just with ethnic backgrounds and socioeconomic backgrounds, but just streams of Christianity. How many of you grew up in a Baptist church? Real slowly raise your hand. I mean, I know. You're scared. I'm getting, put your Bible down and raise your hand, all right? That's good. All right, look around. Raise your hand again. Baptist, maroon? Just want you to do it twice. That's good. All right. All right, how many mainline Presbyterian, Methodist, Lutheran? Raise, yeah, there you go. Be quiet. Don't scare her. All right. That's good. That's good. That's good. And did I mention Catholic? How many Catholic backgrounds? Oh, yeah. There you are. There you are. You forgive it. All right. That's good. How many of you Pentecostal charismatic? Yeah. Right. You saw you in worship. Yes, no need to raise your hand. All right. We've already seen you today. Okay. It's good stuff. We come from so many. This is my favorite part. How many of you had no church background when you came to here? Seriously, raise them up high. Come on, raise them back up. Love it. Absolutely love it if you chose to come and worship with us. And I just want to encourage you today. God's doing such great things in our church family. And a burning passion we've had for the last 10 years. The question we've been asking is, if Pure Heart was gone tomorrow, would we be missed? And we could say yes. With School Connect Ministry, with 267 schools last year that we served at, with 10,000 plus volunteers, and now Tracy Beal is able to be full-time in School Connect Ministry because of the generosity through you as a church family. Foster care and adoption ministry, Project 127, more kids and forever families. How many of you are adoptive or foster parents? Would you raise your hands today? Look at them around the room. Come on. Give them a good hand. Ready to move our resource center to the 100 building, which is about 30% bigger than our current resource center. We want to see 3,000 plus people a month come through to find a job, to help them with food, to help them with clothing. We want to give a hand up and not just a hand out. Amen in life? So we'll be doing that with our first construction project this year as we move forward on this campus. We have a passion to do missions with other churches. Now 75 plus churches are connected with us, serving in our community and around the world. Churches like CCV and Vineyard and Calvary and Christ Community and Palm Croft Baptist, just to name a few, that say, you know what, we're not going to be divided anymore by name. We're going to be united around the name of Jesus Christ. We invested this last year in 3 church starts. 1 church start, we were able to start and pay for all their startup costs. Another one, we were able to write a check for a down payment for their new building they just bought over in El Mirage. Another millennial church, where they were struggling financially, we were able to write a check and bless them because of God's generosity through you. And then in 2 weeks, I get to announce to you our very first satellite campus. I want to tell you right now, but I can't. But trust me, when I let you know, you're going to say to yourself, that's exactly where Pure Heart would put their first satellite. That is exactly where Pure Heart would be, because that's where Jesus would be. And that's the kind of heart we have for people who are going through what these folks are going through. Our first satellite will be announced in 2 weeks. I cannot wait to tell you. But you can't. Okay, so there's three big issues we're going to tackle this year on our campus. Next Gen Spaces. We're getting ready to build a brand new 28,000 square foot children's facility for our kiddos. That's going to take place starting this spring. We're very excited for that. And then Community Space, we're going to have a restaurant on our campus. And I would love to tell you the name of the restaurant, but I can't yet, but I will soon, okay? I've eaten, there's already a restaurant established in our community. I've eaten there. It's fantastic. It's really, really good. And they're going to come on our campus and open this restaurant, and we're going to bless them, and they're going to bless us. And we're going to have a place for 250 people at a time to gather on our campus, to be together, to have community together, before service for breakfast, after service for lunch, Saturday nights for dinner. It's going to rock and roll throughout the week. You can bring your friends. I can't wait to tell you. Okay, number three, we're going to add 120 parking spaces to our campus. I'm excited about that. We need parking spaces on it. We park about 50 to 80 cars down at McDonald's every weekend and shuttle people up. And we're hoping to be able to get our whole family on our campus here starting, hopefully by the end of this year, get that parking place taken care of as well. It has been an amazing year. So let's just give you some highlights. Here's some numbers from 2016. Let's just praise God together as we watch these numbers roll by. Today, or maybe somebody you want to meet, let's do that across the room, all right? I'm just kidding on that last part. Okay. Let's just give God grace. Let's just give God thanks. Father, we thank you. Oh, that started a conversation right there, didn't it? Just joining hands, and you were like, hey, nice to meet you. All right. My name's Dave. Okay. Well, there's a date night challenge coming up. All right. Just kidding. Let's pray. Let's thank God for this last year. Father, we take this moment to say, Jesus, you're the reason for everything that's happened on this campus and around the world through our lives. You are the reason. You're the rock upon which Pure Heart is built. And right now in this moment, we give you all the honor, praise, and glory, Jesus Christ. You are the reason for everything the good that happens in this place. And we thank you We thank you, Holy Spirit, for your power and your strength. It's because of you in our hearts. It's because of you in our lives. You cause us to be generous. There's nothing good in us. You are the good in us, Holy Spirit. And we thank you for that. And Father, we thank you for your great love for us. We look forward to an amazing year in your grace, amazing year in your strength, and great impact. We give you 2017. This is your year in our lives. We commit our lives personally and corporately to your will for Pure Heart and for us individually as church members. In Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Give God a big hand. He may be seated. Here we go. Brand new series for the new year. New beginnings. Well, this is a season of new beginnings. January is a time for us to break old habits and start healthy ones. Yes?
Yes.
Like half of you were into that. Okay. How many of you started a new diet already this year? Ah, fun, fun. How many joined a gym? Anybody? Drove by a gym. Just involve everybody. Drove by a gym. I've read this so many times. I love it. A wife bought her husband a week of private instruction at a health club. This is his journal. I called and made reservations with someone named Tanya. She is a 26-year-old aerobic instructor and athletic clothing model. My wife seemed very pleased to see how enthusiastic I was to get started. They suggested I keep an exercise diary to chart my progress this week. Day 1. Started the morning at 6 a.m. Tough to get out of bed, but worth it when I arrived at the health club and Tanya was waiting for me. She is something of a goddess with blonde hair and a dazzling white smile. She showed me the machines and took my pulse after 5 minutes on the treadmill. She was alarmed it was so high, but I think just standing next to her added 10 points. Tanya was very encouraging as I did my sit-ups, although my gut already ached a little from holding it in the whole time I was talking to her. This is going to be great. Day 2. Took a whole pot of coffee to get me out the door this morning, but I made it. Tanya made me lie on my back and push a heavy iron bar into the air, and then she put weights on it. My legs were a little wobbly on the treadmill, but I made it a whole mile. But her smile made it all worthwhile, muscles feeling great. Day 3. The only way I can brush my teeth is by laying a toothbrush on the counter and moving my mouth back and forth. Driving was okay as long as I didn't try to steer. Tanya was a little impatient when we said that my screaming was bothering the other club members. Day 4. Tanya was waiting for me with vampire-like teeth and full snarl. I can't help it if I was a half hour late. It took me that long just to tie my stinking shoes. I hid in the men's room until they sent Lance in to look for me. Day 5. I hate Tanya. More than any human has ever hated another human in the history of the world. There was a part of my body not in extreme pain. I would hit her with it. Today she told me we were going to work triceps. I don't have any triceps. Day 6. Got Tanya's message on the answering machine. Wondering where I am. I lack the strength to even use the TV remote, so I watched 11 hours of the Weather Channel. Day 7. Well, that's the week. Thank God it's over. Maybe next year my wife will give me something just a little more fun, like a kidney stone or a root canal. How many of you have an area of your life in which you need a new beginning? You're just ready for a fresh start. What if that desire was something deep down inside of you that actually had a theological basis to it? What if you were made to be recreated? What if deep down inside you, God understands that you have places and areas of your heart where you are desperate for a recreation, for a new beginning? Paul writes to his friends in Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and he's talking about that one day we'll have a new body. He's talking about the resurrection of the dead, and one day we'll have this new body, and then he goes deeper than just the physical body. He goes down deep into our soul, down deep into our spirit. This is what he says. If anyone is where? In Christ. And let me just say, as we start this year off, that all the transformation you long for begins in a relationship with Jesus Christ. He is the great transformer. He is the one who laid his life down on a cross because he loves you and rose again from the dead because he has the power over everything. He is the one that can transform your life. Are you in him this year? Are you in a relationship, a deep commitment to Jesus? No more games in 2017. Amen? No more games. No more tradition of religion in 2017. authentic relationship with Jesus is what our soul longs for. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, and I love this next part. He goes so much deeper. The new creation has come. Oh, one day we'll have a new body. How many are excited about that? But he says, the new creation has already started inside of you. And guess what? It was easier for God to create the world out of nothing than to recreate the human heart. You see, when he created the world out of nothing, he spoke and it came into existence. There was nothing opposing him. One of the greatest things that I understand about creation is you can't get something from nothing. Amen. You have to have someone before you can have something. There has to be something to make something. You can't get nothing out of thin air. Even if you believe in the Big Bang Theory, here's my question for you today. Who banged? That's all I want to know, okay? God created everything out of nothing because he is God, King of the universe, the great creator. You have to go back to the origin, to the beginning. Where did this all start? How did this all begin? And I believe with all my heart, and many of you sitting in this room today believe that we have a creator who loves us, and he created this world. But this new creation is deeper than just this world. You see, in my heart, there's opposition to God from time to time. There's my own self-will. There's my own stubbornness. There's my own greed. There are a lot of things in your heart, in my heart, that want to oppose God, and yet he has been doing a new creation inside of you. He is creating a new heart. How many are excited about that today? New creation. But then he goes on. He says, this is about our relationship with God, but then he involves someone else. All this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us, who's us? Gave us the ministry of reconciliation. He committed to us the message of reconciliation. He goes on the next day, but watch how far he takes this. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors. What he's saying is, this relationship with God matters, but our relationships with one another matter greatly as well. Listen, friends, I am better, I am stronger because of Jesus in you. I need you in my life. I was not made to do this life on my own. And new beginnings, a new creation in your life happens in deep relationship with God and strong relationship with one another. We need each other. Change happens in community. That's where change takes place. And this idea of strong relationship with God and strong relationship with one another is throughout the Bible. Let's look at several other places this morning. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 22. The writer of Hebrews says this, let us draw near to who? To God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings. Go down here to the bottom. It says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he, who's he? Good job, everybody. God, good. Jesus, good job. I'm just saying. For he who promised is
faithful.
It's all about this relationship with God. And watch what the writer of Hebrews says next. Check this out. And let us consider how we may spur one another on to love and good deeds. Not giving up meeting together during the NFL season. Welcome back, by the way. That's what it says right there in the Greek, somewhere hidden. Not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. See, we need each other. I was made for a relationship, but that's not the only place. We can go on and on. Let's go to 2 Timothy. Paul's writing a letter to his son in the faith, Timothy. This is what he says. He's like, Timothy, I'm about to leave this life. He says, my life is almost over this side of heaven, for I'm already being poured out like a drink offering. And the time of my departure is near. I've fought the good fight, Timothy. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness. And look who's giving this crown to him, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will reward to me on that day. But Timothy, I have this amazing relationship with God the Father. I have this amazing relationship with Jesus Christ, his son. And he has walked me through all this stuff of my life. And you know the very next thing, Paul writes to Timothy, the very next statement, right after this amazing declaration, verse 9, this is what he says. Do your best to come to me. I've got this strong relationship with God, Timothy, but get here as fast as your legs can carry you. Why? Because I need this relationship with God. And by the way, Timothy, I need you in my life as well. Paul doesn't end there in the book of Philippians, chapter 4. Paul is writing again to his friends in Philippi. He's in prison during this time. And he's talking about how he's learned the secret to be content in every situation. And Philippians 4:13 is a famous section of scripture. Many of us know it translated in many different ways. Like, I do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And this is what it said in the NIV. I can do all this through him. Who's him? Good job, class. You're getting better. Who gives me what? And do you know what verse 14 says? Anybody in the house know what verse 14 says? No, because we stopped right there. We memorized that. We stopped in our refrigerator years ago. We bought a little Precious Moments figurine, you know? You know, a little girl holding a dead cat. I can get through all things, you know? You don't have that Precious Moments box? Ansel Adams picture? House on the Plain? I don't know. All right. I can do all things, all this from Him who gives me strength. Verse 14, read it out loud. Ready, go. Yet it was good of you to share my troubles. Man, I can do all things through Christ. Oh, by the way, it was really good of you to come and carry my burden. It's really good of you to love me enough to walk with me, to not give up on you. I need you in my life. Chapter 1 of the book of Philippians, Paul writes one of the most tender thoughts in the New Testament. He is so overwhelmed for his love for his brothers and his sisters in the city of Philippi. And I want you, men, I want you, this is a man writing, this is a man writing. This is the heart of God flowing through Paul. A man who was beaten to death several times, hit, well, he didn't die, he did. But he was beaten near death several times. Sorry, I'm going to stop happy right now. Paul says this, it is right for me to feel this way about you, since I have you in my heart. Where does this new creation begin? Our hearts. When we're in Christ and we're in relationship and fellowship with one another. And whether I'm in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify, and this is a man writing, remember this, under the power of God's Spirit, how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. Men, do you have somebody in your life? Do you have a man in your life? You just can't wait to see him. I was up north recently to see one of my buddies, Greg Mingarelli. I've known 24 years in ministry. In Prescott, Arizona, with our staff, hanging out, praying. We spent the first 24 hours together as a staff this year praying for this church family, for our future. We just started the year saying, Jesus, we need you. Nothing happens without you. That's where we started. I was up there, and I got to see Greg, and I was like, I can't wait to see him. Can't wait to get reconnected and talk. When we saw each other, it was like we hadn't been apart. Just hung out together, laughed together, talked together. That's deep friendship. Right here in this room, sitting in this room today, there are men who have spurred me on. Men have come into my life over the last year, and men have been in my life for 17, 18 years since I've been here at Pure Heart. You have loved me, and you have encouraged me, and you have strengthened me. And I am better because of Jesus in you. I just want to start this year off by reminding you, you don't have to be alone. You don't. You were made for relationship with God. You were made for relationship with one another. And at Pure Heart, you can find the new beginning you're longing for, because we are in love with Jesus, and we loved you before you loved us. We built this place with you in mind. We couldn't wait for you to show up. All of you who joined us in this last year, we couldn't wait for you to get here. We built this auditorium during the Great Recession with you in mind. We sacrificed with you in mind. We loved you before you loved us. You are in a safe place. And thousands of them are going for the next 2 years. We already love them, don't we? And it's worth it for us to give up parts of our life and to sacrifice financially and do what it takes so we can see people strong in our community. So we can live forever together with our Heavenly Father. We have a message that is the hope of the world. Amen? This is the biggest deal there is. And I am honored to lead with you. I am honored to serve with you. I cannot do this without you. And here's what Paul goes on and prays. And our whole staff, not our whole staff, a bunch of our staff members got together. And we were impressed. And here's what we pray. We pray the same prayer that Paul prayed. This is verse 9. He says, and this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight. And we took the first half of the first day together. And we pray that God would take our love for one another and our love for him to a whole new place in 2017. That when visitors walk on this campus this year, they'll be like, man, these people really like each other. What is going on? That's a good thing, right? So you're like, man, I got two or three I'm not real fond of. Okay. These people like each other. These people love each other. Something is happening here. I want to be a part of it. And I know that God's going to do that in our lives this year. A whole new level. And so I want to start this year by simply saying, we need to be deep in our relationship with Christ. Deepen our relationship with one another, because the new beginning you're longing for happens in those relationships. Everybody says,
amen.
Amen. Amen. So let's just stand and greet 35 people and come glad to see them, all right? Come on.
Well.
No. I want to take my last 7 minutes and 21 seconds. I want to be a little extra perky in 7 minutes. To be real personal with you, all right? I sat with a group of pastors the other day, and I was sharing with them thoughts about 2016 and how grateful I was that those pastors were in my life. And I went around the table and just said, you know, here's how you strengthen me, here's how you strengthen me, here's how you strengthen me. When I got done, one of my friends said to me, one of my friends in ministry said, Dan, I really needed that today. I need to be reminded of that. And so I want to end our first talk of the year with just being very personal about why I need you in my life, why I need a relationship with Christ and one another. And the first big thing I have in my life that I need from community is I need someone that's going to cheer me up. And I need someone that's going to celebrate with me and encourage me. You know what we don't do well as Christians? As people. We don't celebrate really well with people when they're doing well. You know, if you want to know who the real friends are in your life, not those who are there for you when you're down and out. Because there's some people who have a great gift of mercy, and they'll be there for you, especially when you're down and out. You ever notice you got some people, they'll be there when you're down and out, but then they disappear? Okay, then never mind. All right. So, but those people that when you get that raise, or you get that promotion, or you have that child and they don't have a child, you get that grandchild and they don't have a grandchild yet, or something good happens in your life, they can't celebrate with you. I need people in my life who are willing to love me enough that when things are going well, they can go praise God.
Amen.
Yeah. Praise God. I'm excited for you. I was sitting in a meeting years ago, and Pure Heart was just starting to zoom. We were just taking off. And in this meeting, there were about 4 or 5 other pastors, and their churches were struggling with it. And so we just prayed with each other, and we're hanging out together. We got to the end of our prayer time, and one of the pastors looked up and said, Dan, you didn't share anything today. And in my mind, I'm like, and I don't want to talk about what's happening here now, because that's just going to be, you know, like, hey, rub it in a little bit. Sorry, things are tough for you right now. And my friend looked at me, my good friend today. He looked at me and said, don't you dare do that. And I'm like, don't I dare do what? He goes, because I'm like, you know, I'm done. It's almost time is up. I don't need to share. He's like, don't you do that. And I go, Lynn, what else are we going to do? He goes, don't you dare rob me of the opportunity to celebrate what Jesus is doing in Pure Heart. Because we're a part of Pure Heart. Because we are the body of Christ. And I was like, in that moment, I just said, you know what? That's a friend. That's a friend. Somebody who can celebrate with you when things are going well. Who doesn't walk in your house and go, boy, did you need a closet this big? Oh my, you need to have that many shoes? Oh my goodness. Really? You had to have a truck that big? The tires that big? Really? Yeah, to run over you. No, just kidding. I'm kidding. That's a joke. Love, bro, love. And if not, secondly, I need someone to pick me up. Because all of us fall. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when I fall, I need someone to pick me up. When you fall, you need somebody to pick you up. The three big words and the biggest question in the human heart are simply these. Have you ever? Man, we need somebody in our life that we can ask that question. Have you ever destroyed your finances to a point you didn't know if you ever did your way out? Have you ever jacked up your marriage so bad you didn't know if trust would ever happen again? Have you ever longed to be married and wondered if anyone will ever love you? Have you ever had a child that's run wild? That rhymed. It was kind of cool, wasn't it? Have you ever? I remember walking with my friend Mark Buckley years ago. We're taking a hike together, and he looked at me and he started telling me about his nervous breakdown that he had, his anxiety attacks. I hadn't been able to share with anybody what I was going through. I had blood clots going to my lungs, and I had anxiety attacks that you wouldn't believe. I could barely get up in front of talking in front of people. I had to have somebody teach with me. We were back in the gymnasium at the time. For almost 7 or 8 months, I had somebody teach with me just because I couldn't catch my breath. I was so anxious. And if you've ever had a panic attack, you wouldn't wish it on your worst enemy. And I was having these panic attacks, and Mark Buckley looked me right in the eyes. You know what he said to me? He answered my question, have you ever? Mark, have you ever been so nervous and anxious and so overwhelmed that you couldn't teach? And Mark looked at me and goes, you know, when I was 39, 20 years of age, I started having anxiety attacks, and the Lord really walked me through it. I had friends I could talk to about it. And I just was like broken. Because he answered this big stinking question. Have you ever? And you know what empathy, we throw the word empathy around a lot. You know what empathy means? Empathy simply means this. Me too. Me too. And in godly community, we find people that can look us in the eyes and go, yeah, me too. I don't have it all together just like you. We have to have that. Someone to cheer me on. Someone to pick me up. And the third thing is this. I need someone to love me enough to tell me the truth. I need someone who would be willing to look me in the eyes and love Jesus and say, I love you, and I'm going to tell you the truth. I was sitting with some pastor friends the other day, And one of my buddies, one of our new pit groups, Pastor Incumbent Group, we started. We were kind of going around the circle, and one of my buddies looks at me and goes, "Hey, is this going to become one of those groups where we're willing to tell each other the truth?" He says, "Because I don't have time if it's not." I was just like, "Well, settle down." And then he smiled and said, "Here, guys, here's what I need from you. I need you to tell me the truth when you see my life getting jacked up. When you hear stuff coming out of my heart that isn't good, when I'm not talking right about my family, I need you to love me enough to say, listen, bro, you got to calm down, slow your ride. You need to pray about this. We need to talk to you. You show me somebody who resists truth, I'll show you somebody who doesn't want to move again. You show me somebody who's not seeking truth and wanting to receive truth from others, I'll show you somebody who doesn't really want to change. If you show me somebody who is seeking truth and longing for truth, I will show you somebody who really, really wants to change. I need somebody like that. I need people who love me enough to tell me the truth. So new. Because the truth sets us free. Amen?
Amen.
The truth keeps us strong. And I'm telling you, friends, you can find that here. You do not have to be alone. I don't know if I shared this already in the service because I'm just kind of just going with my heart today. Years ago, I was sitting in an office with Bill Hybels and a few other pastors. He looked at us and he just simply said, "Guys, loneliness is a choice." And in my mind, I went, "You're wrong." And then he rephrased it and said, "Feeling lonely, you can't help. But what you do once you feel lonely is all about you." He says, it's a choice as a leader to be alone. And way too many leaders choose to be alone. Way too many Christians choose to be alone. In this place, if you look in your bulletin notes right now with me across the room, you'll see question number three, right in the middle, question number three. In your life, who in your life is there for you to cheer you on, pick you up, and tell you the truth? I want to encourage you to take some time this week to fill in those blanks. Who are the people that are that in your life? And then you know what? If you say, "Man, I don't have that," here's some action steps for you right afterwards. Maybe for some of you who are new around here, maybe it's time to go to Welcome to Family class. Maybe join that Move class if you're new in your relationship with Christ. Maybe get into a small group this year. Maybe you were in a group before. Time to get back into community, back into a small group, and just talk about life. Maybe just serve together. Guys, I know for some of us, it's not easy for us to hang out in a small group and just talk. We'd like to do something, go to our website, go to the serve tab, and find a place to serve. Get serving with other people. Then you can build relationships by serving with other people. You don't have to be alone this year. And everybody say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Paul goes on in his letter to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4. Here's what I want to end with. You see, all of us have had people in our life that we love that let us down. That's the hard part about community, right? Is that people have the propensity to let you down. Just turn to your neighbor right now and say, "You have the potential to bug me." Just do that. It's true. We got the potential. Okay? Paul writes, he says, "That my first defense..." Okay, come back to me. "That my first defense, no one came to my support. Everyone deserted me." Maybe you're here today and you feel that way. "May it not be held against them, I love the forgiveness. But the Lord stood at my side and gave me the strength. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom." And I want to end this message by reminding you, yeah, we were made for a relationship with one another, but from time to time we let each other down. But there's one relationship that will never fail us. There's one who will always be there to walk with us, and that is Jesus. And so just bow your head to me for a moment. Are you in Christ today? No more games in 2017. For some of you sitting here and listening online, today is the day you need to make that decision for the first time. Jesus, be Lord of my life. For others of you, maybe it's a rededication of your life to Jesus Christ. So you need to come home to him. Truth is, you've been doing your own thing and going your own way. But man, here you are today. You are not in this room by chance. And God's in love with you. You want to slow your roll down long enough to just remind you that he wants a relationship with you. So if that's you today, for the first time in your life, or today's a rededication of your life to Christ, what we do right here in this room is we raise our hand. When you raise your hand, you're simply saying, "That's me. I need Jesus and no more games." If that's you, without hesitation, would you just raise your hand really high right now? Absolutely. Keep your hand open. Keep raising. And there, and there, and there, and there, and there. Oh, yes. Yeah, that's awesome. Yes, yes. Anyone else? I need Christ today. All over the room. It's so good. All of you with your hands raised, just put them down right now. Pray this in your heart. God hears you. Lord Jesus, right now in this moment, say this to him: "I commit my life to you. trust you with my future. Fill me with your spirit. Fill me with your strength. This is important. Forgive me of my sins. You know what it is? I've been wrong. Thank you. Thank you that you would love me enough to not give up on me, to forgive me, to bring me back home to you. I look forward to knowing you, Jesus, knowing you deeply. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Give God a big hand. Come on. 2017, here we go.
So the decision you made just by raising your hand is the best thing that you could ever do. It's just your first step, though. We want to come alongside you and walk with you to help you discover what does it mean to become like Christ and even for the sake of others. So we have some people that are going to come down to where you are, those of you that raised your hand, try to meet with you. If we don't get to you, we're going to have someone right down here. We'd love for you to come down, talk with that person. I know it can be scary, so if a friend is with you, come down with them. We really want to walk with you through life and what it means to grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ. We've also set up a room just across the patio. Follow the move signs up the stairs to 522, room 522. And we'd love to continue that conversation with you guys. So please do that. We'd love to walk with you. Also, if you're visiting with us for the very first time, there's a little tear-off section in your bulletin. If you would mind filling that out, take it to the information center on your way out the door today. What's that?
I'm just helping you.
You're helping me? You're a good man, buddy. Showing you, that's the man of white thing.
No, right
there. Gotcha.
So yes, stop at the information center. That way we can continue to communicate with you, let you know what's going on at the church, let you know what God is doing here. And finally, if God has touched your heart today through the message, we'd love to pray with you, to minister to you. We're going to have our prayer team right up here to your right, my left. They would love to meet with you, pray with you. You guys have an awesome weekend.
Have a great weekend, everybody.